Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the San Luis Obispo Catholic Newman Center First Theology Forum. We're super excited to have you here to engage in a discussion that basically introduces Catholic theology. And with us here today, my name is Genevieve, and with us here today we have Karen Schindler, who is our campus minister, that will be just walking us through this journey. But first and foremost, since we're Catholic, we're going to start with a prayer that Karen is going to go ahead and lead us in.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. So happy to be with you here today. And a special shout out to my confirmation students for whom this theology series is first and foremost intended for. We were going to have some slides, but because of some technical difficulties, I'm just going to be reading what's on the slides. Very sad, because they had a beautiful picture of the creation of Adam from the Sistine Chapel by Michelangelo, but you'll just have to imagine that. Anyway, our first slide then is the prayer we're going to start with, which is a prayer to the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of thy faithful, and enkindle in them the fire of thy love. Send forth thy Spirit, and they shall be created, and thou shalt renew the face of the earth. St. John Henry Newman, pray for us. St. John Paul II, pray for us. Our Lady of the Rosary, whose feast we celebrate today,
pray for us.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So, as Genevieve said, we're going to start with just an overall introduction to Catholic theology. And I think a good place to start for any series about Catholic theology would be with an acknowledgement to the sorts of questions that would lead you to get interested in a series of Catholic theology. Questions like, should I join a church? Or why am I a member of a church or a religion? And if I am a member of a church or a religion, why is it Catholic, as opposed to another church or religion? Now, before we can answer those questions, we would first have to delve into a set of even deeper questions, more existential questions like, who am I? What am I doing here? What am I meant for? What was I created for? Is there more to life than all this, you know, going to college, getting a job, making money, being successful, yada yada. Now, it's not a mistake or an accident that you feel the closest to getting these questions answered, these existential questions, when you are in love. And I think anybody who has been in love can attest to that fact. And that is because all of us, whether we realize it or not, are protagonists in a love story right now. The very fact that you were born landed you inescapably within a cosmic love story. And it is a love story that is so prodigious and so magnificent that you could never have imagined it on your own. It was a story that had to be revealed to us. And it's a story of a God who was complete and sufficient in and of himself, but he was so full of love and joy and beauty and goodness that he just had to share all of this with somebody other than himself. And because there was nobody other than himself, he had to create this other. And then we're going to call her her at this point. And then when he saw her, because she was so beautiful, being the work of his hands, whose beauty himself, he promptly fell in love with her. And then he began this pursuit of her because he wanted more than anything to live in union with her. Okay, so obviously I'm speaking, when I say her, I'm speaking of creation. or the world, of which you and I are the most important part. Now, the union then of this creation of this world with the God who desires union with it is called the Church. Now, if this seems too fantastical and too overly romantic to be true, I mean, really, the place we go to go to Mass on Sunday, what, all this love story business? Well, perhaps we should look in the Church's literature, or especially the Church's special book, which, as you know, is the Bible. And if we do look in the Bible, we see, in fact, a huge love story. So we're going to start with the very beginning of the Bible. And this is in Genesis, the first book in the opening chapters. We have, at the end of chapter 1, how God, the story of creation. Well, it begins with the story of creation, and then by the end of the first chapter, God has taken 6 days to create the world. And then he takes a step back and he looks at it and he finds it very good. So I'm going to read what Genesis says. And God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thus the heavens and earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. Now, the word good here that is used when it's written that God saw everything that he had made and behold it was very good is the Greek word for kolon. At least it is in the Septuagint, which is the first Greek translation of the Hebrew Bible. And the Greek word kolon, maybe I can, oh, well, I won't complicate things, but the Greek word of kolon means beautiful to look at or beautiful to see. So what that passage says is that God sees this creation as very beautiful to see. And then when it says he rested in it, the meaning of the Hebrew word for rest is closer to this idea of resting in something or delighting in something. So God sees it's very beautiful and then he delights in it, okay? So he basically falls in love with it. Now, if you think that's a stretch, then let's look at the works of two Christian writers who are commenting about the creation of the world. The first is Dionysius the Areopagite, who was a Greek writer in the first century. And in his book, The Divine Names, in chapter 4, he talks about this erotic, he uses the word eros, this erotic yearning of God for the universe that he creates. And we must dare to affirm, for 'tis true, I love how he says that, that the creator of the universe himself, in his beautiful and good yearning towards the universe, now, our translation is yearning, but he actually uses the word eros here, is through the excessive yearning of his goodness transported outside of himself in his providential activities towards all things that have being, and is touched by the sweet spell of goodness, love, and yearning, and so is drawn from his transcendent throne above all things to dwell within the heart of all things. Hence, doctors call him jealous, because he is vehement in his good yearning towards the world, and because he stirs men up to a zealous search of yearning desire for him. Then we have another writer who's quite a bit later in the 16th century, a writer named John of the Cross, who was a Spanish monk, and he wrote this beautiful poem about the first chapter of John, the chapter that's begins, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. By him all things were created. And in this poem, he creates this dialogue between the Father and the Son. Now, a word for those who may not be familiar with this point, but the Christian God is only one God, but there are three persons in it, right? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So St. John of the Cross takes the two persons, the Father and the Son, and he creates this dialogue about this bride that the Father wants to give the Son, and he's talking about creation. My son, I wish to give you a bride who will love you. Because of you, she will deserve to share our company, that she may know the good I have in such a son, and rejoice with me in your grace and fullness. I am very grateful, the son answered. I will show my brightness to the bride you give me. I will hold her in my arms, and she will burn with your love. Let it be done then, said the father, for your love has deserved it. And by these words, the world was created. Now, if we go back to the Bible, we have all these passages in Jeremiah, OC, Isaiah, Ezekiel, that speak about God's people as his bride, as his chosen bride, and he longs after this bride, and the bride is unfaithful to him, but he is true to his bride. But we don't have time to go into all those passages. So I want to move through the whole Bible until we get to the very end. And just as we saw at the beginning, at the very end, we have another reference to this love story. And that is in the book of Revelations. And now, in the book of Revelations, St. John is talking about the church. And now remember what we said about the church. That is the people of God who live in union with the God who created them, right? In this passage, she's referred to as the New Jerusalem. And that is because Jerusalem was the city of the Jews where the temple was. And the temple was the place where the Shekinah was. And the Shekinah is the Hebrew word meaning the presence of God. So God dwelt with his people in the temple in Jerusalem. So the church, or the union of God with his people, is called the New Jerusalem in this passage. I saw the New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. So here is the Bible, right? The book of the church. It is all about a love story. It begins with a love story. You see the love story woven throughout all the pages in between, and then it ends with it. Okay, so that brings us back to the initial question. Why should I join a church? Well, hopefully I've shown that you should join the church because that is the only way that you're going to find that something more for which your heart inevitably and ardently longs, because that something more is God, is your union with God, and that is precisely why God created you in the first place. So that is why you want to join the church. Now, the next question, why the Catholic Church, is a little more complicated, but I'm going to give you an argument for why it would be the Catholic Church. Now, the first point in my argument is that if this love story is true, then there's one God who desires union with his creatures, right? Well, by virtue of that fact, all those creatures, insofar as they are united to that one God, are also in union with each other, right? So we have one God and one group of people who are in union with him, or one assemblage. And that one assemblage or congregation or group of people is the one church. So one God, one church. Now the second point is, if that's true, then everybody who is living in union with God in some degree or fashion is a member of that church, whether they realize it or not, Now, we could reframe that point and identify God with truth. And we can do that, right? Because the second person of the Blessed Trinity that John of the Cross was talking about came to earth in the person of Jesus Christ. So Jesus Christ is God. And when he was here, he called himself the truth, right? So we can reframe this whole question in terms of truth. And that means anyone who is living their lives in accord with the truth is a part of the church, whether they realize it or not. Now, one qualification needs to be made here, especially nowadays when there's all this talk of your truth and my truth. Okay, when I say the truth, I'm not talking about a relative truth. I'm talking about the objective, absolute truth. Catholic Church is very clear on that. She doesn't believe in relative truth. She believes in absolute truth. Okay, so we have then one God and one church. Okay, so the next thing is, well, how is this church, how do we know that this church is the Catholic Church? Well, that's because of the name Catholic, which comes from the Greek word katholikos, meaning universal or whole. So just by virtue of the name, the Catholic Church, we mean the one universal church that contains all those who are united to God or to truth in any way. Okay? So that is why you would like to be a member of the Catholic Church. Now, I have yet to show that the church I am representing right now is in fact that Catholic Church or that one universal church. I'll get to that, but I hope at least that I have given you a reasonable argument for why you would want to join a church in the first place and why that church should be the Catholic Church. And that brings me to the graphic. I just want to show that in fact, all of Catholic doctrine can be summed up in this mystery, that because we don't have graphics, I have to draw out for you, right? So, okay. Okay, so we can write in here the Catholic mystery. Or doctrine. Okay. By the way, a shout out to Christine who took all the time to make the graphic online and we're not even using it. Insofar as something is done for love, it's never wasted, right? Okay. So, bringing back a lot of memories from all my years of teaching. This is the point at which the class went crazy. Okay. Because my back was to it.
We should have a laugh track.
What's that?
We should have a laugh track.
What does that mean? What, to throw something? And because he loves what he creates, he wants to become one with it. And this he actually and literally does in the person of Jesus Christ, who is God who becomes flesh. So he becomes one with this material creation. Okay, so he becomes the God-man. As the God-man, he's the going to be discussing this term in a later lesson, and our Savior. Now, because this is a union of love and not of violence, God needs the consent, the full, perfect consent on behalf of his creation, right? Because that's the person or the other with whom he's seeking union. So he gets that perfect, complete yes from Mary, the Virgin Mary. Okay, Mary gives him that yes, and then from that yes, he's able to unite with creation in the person of Jesus Christ. So she becomes the mother of Jesus Christ. But not only that, because she is the personification and representation of all of creation, she also is the way through which God joins himself with that, the rest of creation. And so she's the way the church is established. So through Mary, we have the church. Now, as the people who are united with God, she's a bride. The bride we were talking about in the book of Revelations and in the Bible. But because she's also the way through which this union is effected, she becomes a sacrament. Now, we don't have time to go into exactly what a sacrament means in this lesson, but it's a deep mystery that affects union with God. Okay, so she is both the bride and the sacrament. Now, because this is what the church is all about, the union of God and his creation, the church is necessarily Eucharistic. And for those who don't know, Eucharist is the term for what we do every Sunday, right? We go to Mass and we celebrate the Eucharist, which is the bread and wine that we believe has been transformed into the body and blood of Christ, whom, as we know, is the God-man. Okay? So in the Eucharist, we have the actual, literal union between God and his church, or his creation. Right? God, or bread and wine, transformed into the body and blood of God. Okay? And that is why the church is always Eucharistic, and why John Paul II says in his letter on the Eucharist, it is the source and the summit of the Christian life, or we could say in this case, the Catholic life. So there is the whole Catholic mystery. And that brings us to a close, but I wanted to end with a beautiful passage in Christian literature that encapsulates perhaps more than any other passage the breadth of this pursuit of God for his creation. This passage was written by St. Augustine, who was not only one of the greatest thinkers of the Catholic Church, but one of the greatest thinkers of the Western world. And he wrote about his journey to becoming a Catholic in his book, The Confessions. And it took him a while. He actually didn't convert to Catholicism, and actually it was called Christianity back then. It didn't, the Christian church didn't assume the word Catholic Church until a little later, but anyway, the church he joined was the Catholic Church, but he didn't join it until he was about middle age, after pursuing truth for the whole of his youth. But he finally found that truth, and then he fell in love with it, and he tells this story in his Confessions. And I'm just going to read a beautiful passage from the Confessions. Too late have I loved you, beauty so ancient yet so new. Too late have I loved you. And see, you were within, and I was in the external world and sought you there. And in my unlovely state, I plunged into those lovely created things which you made. You were with me, and I was not with you. The lovely things kept me far from you, though if they did not have their existence in you, they had no existence at all. You called and cried out loud and shattered my deafness. You were radiant and resplendent. You put to flight light my blindness. You are fragrant, and I drew in my breath and now pant after you. I tasted you, and I feel but hunger and thirst for you. You touched me, and I am set on fire to attain the peace which is yours. And that's it.
Well, thank you so much, Karen, for just going through all of that. Even just, you know, I grew up in the Catholic Church, but I've even just learned so much just listening to you. And right now, just for all of those that are watching, it's our chance to ask any sort of questions. So you can put those questions in the comments. But our first question for you is, if you lost sound, go ahead and comment that in there. We just are trying to figure out our system and make sure it's all working out. But with that, we're just going to go ahead and dive into our Q&A session. So comment those questions, and we're definitely excited to answer those. And so, Karen, just kind of my first question for you is, when we look at the Catholic Church, right, it's this big picture, and it's this religion, right? And for somebody that is, you know, stepping into the church for their first time, what exactly, how do they navigate or begin to navigate that sort of relationship aspect within the Catholic Church?
That's a great question. Well, I think it's very true to say that if the Catholic Church is all about relationship, right? As we just showed, this is a relationship between God and his creatures. I think that that whole journey has to begin with relationship, right? It has to begin with an encounter of some sort, an encounter that draws you in to ask for more. I'm thinking of the Gospel of John, or that story when the two apostles come to John the Baptist and they're looking for the truth, right? And Jesus comes. And he's baptized, and then he goes off, right? He doesn't make a huge splash about himself. He just quietly goes on. And then John the Baptist says to the two apostles, go follow him. Behold the Lamb of God. So they follow him, but they must be kind of nervous because they don't ask him any questions, or they don't say, hey, wait up, or anything. And then our Lord, of course, who's God, knows that they're following him, and he knows why, but he has an encounter with them, right? He stops, he turns around, and he says, what do you seek? And they just say, Master, where do you live? And he says, come and see. And I think that is such a beautiful, provocative, line, come and see. And I think a lot of people who begin their journey to the Catholic faith can point back to some kind of encounter. Perhaps it was with somebody that they met or knew. I mean, I've met a lot of students who will say, yeah, I like this girl, and she wanted me to come to her church. And so it started with a relationship, and then they got hooked when they went to the church, either through something the priest said, or something they saw or whatever, and that led them to start asking questions and start coming more often. Sometimes it can just be an encounter with beauty. I was just listening to a talk by Bishop Barron, and he was talking about when he went to Paris, and he was visited the Chartres Cathedral for the first time, and he saw that big rose window, that really famous window. And he said it just completely drew him out of himself and just made him more enamored and even more curious about Christianity. But once again, it was an encounter that led him to seek for more. So that's what I would say. It would be an encounter, most often in the form of a relationship. I can think of another Bible story too, but I don't want to go on too long.
No, that's great. I really love that. I love that you just tie that all in together about how a lot of times we do encounter God through those relationships, and that's kind of the initial step. Which brings me back to, at the beginning, you talked about all of these different questions we ask, right? And so with these different questions, these bigger picture questions, what's the next step? We're asking these questions. We know we want to look for more, but where do we go? If somebody's looking at, you know, becoming Catholic, what's that next step?
Yeah, that's another great question. Well, like I used to tell my students all the time, all good things begin with prayer. So the first place you want to go when you have been touched by something or gotten an invitation, and it doesn't have to be a verbal one, right? Or you've just had this encounter and it draws you in. The first place to really start searching for more answers would be inside yourself, or to start a dialogue with, you know, I mean, this is given that you believe there is a God who is leading you, right? That there is some God to have a relationship with. But most people start asking that question when they start a journey, this journey, right? Is he really up there? Does he really care about me? Notice how it gets very personal. And that's where I would invite everybody to make it even more personal and really open yourself up and just seriously ask him, listen, if you're really there and you really care about me and you really want a relationship with me, then show me yourself. Direct me to the right places. Reveal to me the next step. And he does. He does all the time. He does infallibly. He even said that, right? He says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened to you. And that's just so true all the time. And then just inquire into if you're feeling, if that next step then makes you consider joining a church, then go to the church that is most appealing to you. I know one student who just joined the church this last July came out of nowhere in terms of religion. His family didn't practice any kind of religion, but he had an encounter with truth, right? And he started this personal quest, and it led him first to a Christian church, and he got baptized there. But he kept searching, and he realized it just didn't quite satisfy him, so ultimately his search brought him to the Catholic Church, and he just is thoroughly convinced that this is the church he was looking for. And there are so many stories like that. You know, Chesterton, Genevieve's personal favorite, began his, I mean, he was an atheist, right? But he started this personal quest, and it landed him in the Catholic Church. So many famous writers have had the same journey. So.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we talk about just truth as a whole, obviously, you know, some of these journeys start with asking that question of what is truth and how do we get there? How do we know? I know you mentioned in the name Catholic, that, you know, how exceptional that name is. But how do we know that, you know, we've found it? When does that stop? And how do we know that, say, the Catholic Church is the place to stop?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, another great question, Genevieve. You're asking all the right ones. Well, I think that, you know, the knowledge that you're in the right place is twofold, right? It has to involve the head and the heart. So by head, I mean you have to start asking questions. And if everything makes sense and it all fits in and the dots all can connect, then most likely you're there intellectually. But another huge component of this is here. If it's speaking to you here and you're getting a real heartfelt sense that you've come home, I know St. Augustine got that, right, when he came to the church. I mean, this whole passage I read, it's all about he's been looking and then he finds God, right, and he has this extraordinary sense of coming home. So if that is your experience when you come to the Catholic Church and you start learning about its doctrine and you start attending liturgies, then that would be a good indication that you're probably in the right place, right? Because if God created you for Him, then to the degree that you find Him, that restlessness is going to change into peace and joy and contentment in what you found.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be the best indication that you're actually going down the right path. What are you feeling here? You know? And if it's a good thing, then you want to keep. If it ain't broke, don't fix it, right? You don't want to go somewhere else if what you are encountering is speaking to you.
Great.
What about you? You've mentioned a lot of experiences of other people and how they've encountered truth.
My encounter,
it could be just an example.
I was a cradle Catholic, so I didn't have the journey out of nowhere that so many students have now. I have had to make some pretty drastic decisions in which churches I've been a part of throughout my life, and it was always that sense of peace and being at home and being just welcomed and embraced by the God that I was seeking and pursuing that always gave me the assurance that I was being led by Him and that I was finding myself in the right place. In fact, I was actually outside the church for a time, but I came back to it, and I can't even express the feeling of just being at home, and the joy of knowing that I was a part of this vast group of people, and not just people who were alive at the same time I was, but people that came from centuries before me, people like Augustine or Chesterton or, you know, St. Therese. We were all part of this one church, this one group of people, and it was a very overwhelming sense. So my answers, I guess you could say, come from my own experience. So.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much, Karen, and thank you for just giving us, shedding some light on what the Catholic Church is all about and how we got here and how we can move from here forward. For all of us that tuned in live, thank you so much for being here. We're super excited to engage in these weekly discussions where we're able to ask some of the hardest questions but the most important questions. So thank you so much for being here, and we hope you have a great rest of your evening.